Hi students, welcome back to geology. This week we are learning about minerals. So this first lecture we are going to focus on understanding how minerals are created and understanding how they are the building blocks of rocks. From there, the next lecture we'll talk all about the physical properties of minerals and how you can identify them. All right, so what is a mineral? So the standard definition of a mineral is that it needs to be naturally occurring, inorganic, a crystalline solid with a definite chemical composition. Okay, so it must meet these criteria. The problem with that is that in 1985, we started to make some assumptions about where these minerals are coming from, and some of them are actually coming from organic sources. So previously, it had to be an inorganic material. But in 1985, the mineral definition was revised to include something that could be organic. And so the new mineral definition as of 1985 is a mineral is an element or chemical compound that is normally crystalline and that has been formed from the result of a geologic process. Okay, so that encompasses things that are not necessarily inorganic. Okay, so again, these were changed because of some discrepancies, some things that we learned about how minerals form. And we persevere with science, right? So it's always changing. It's not always set in stone, which we learned at the beginning of the semester. Okay, so minerals are made up of elements, right? So you remember the periodic table of elements. All of those elements can combine in a different fashion to create different minerals. And so, for example, here is a mineral of halite. Halite is made up of sodium and chlorine ions, so NaCl, and it's basically table salt. Okay, so elements are made up of atoms, and the atoms within the elements are made from subatomic particles, so protons, neutrons, electrons. Probably remember some of this from basic chemistry. We'll do a little bit of a touch on reminding you about bonding and things like that. But remember, protons are positive, neutrons have no charge, and electrons are negatively charged. All right, so what makes up our crust in terms of elements? What are we looking at? So you'd be surprised to find out that most of our crust is only a very small fraction of the periodic table of elements. So most of it is oxygen, and the other portion that's huge is silica. So silicon is 27%, oxygen 46%, and then it just starts getting smaller and smaller increments from there. So some of these really specific elements that we see, like nitrogen in the crust, is very small percentage, but there is a lot of nitrogen in the atmosphere, right? So we're talking about the crust here. So we have a lot of different elements on Earth, and like I said, a lot of them make up that 1.5%. So a very small percentage. So when you're looking for something like gold, it makes up such a small percentage of the Earth's crust that it's hard to find, right? At some point, we're going to run out of it and there's not going to be any more to mine. All right, so looking at an atomic structure of an element, we're looking at the nucleus and everything that surrounds it. Okay, so remember, in the nucleus is where we find our protons and our neutrons, and our electrons float in the cloud around. So if you look at that little video, it kind of shows you how the electrons will float around and try to get it to play again. So in your nucleus, there will be a particular amount of protons and neutrons for a given element and a given atom. And then around it is its electron cloud. And that electron cloud usually wants to be happy at 8 electrons. If it doesn't have 8 electrons, it tries to bond with other things to get 8 electrons, or maybe to share and help out a friend and get them to their 8 electron outer shell. And so we do this, or elements do this, through bonding. So an atom will bond to another atom using electron bonding. So whether that is giving away an electron, sharing an electron, or receiving an electron. So if an electron is given away, we call this an ionic bond. So here we have two atoms. One of them has 7 outside electrons and one of them only has 1. And so what ends up happening is when they bond, the one that has the spare, just single outer electron will donate to the one that needs one more to make a happy 8 outer electron. Okay, and that outer shell is also known as the valence shell. So if you took chemistry, maybe you remember that term. But here the important thing is that the bond is between a giving away of an electron. Okay, so that creates a strongish bond, but it's not as strong as a covalent bond. So if you remember from chemistry, covalent bonds are very strong because they share the last electron together. And so they each have each atom has 7 electrons on their outer shell, and they share 2 of those electrons so that they each have 8. And this creates really, really strong materials like diamond. So diamond is made up of a bunch of covalently bonded carbon atoms. And so it creates this really, really strong bond. So when you try to cut diamond, the only thing that's going to cut diamond is a diamond cut blade. So you need diamond in your blade to actually cut the diamond. So it's such a strongly bonded mineral that it's really resistant to a lot of things. All right, so looking at the formation of a mineral, where do they come from? How do we get them? So we know that they're made up of atoms, they're made up of elements that have been bonded together to create this beautiful solid form, crystalline form that we see. And so where do they come from exactly? So they can come from an aqueous solution, water. They can precipitate out of that during a temperature change. They can crystallize out of a magma, or they can come from some sort of biological process. So they can precipitate out of organisms as well, kind of similar to the precipitation out of water. All right, so when they precipitate out of an aqueous solution, this can come in many forms. So we usually call these solutes. So they are material that is dissolved in water, and eventually they would precipitate out and basically collect themselves and concentrate, and then they would solidify and become something that's crystalline. And so this happens a lot in caves. This also includes our evaporites. So when water sits at the surface and evaporates, it leaves behind a lot of NaCl. So a lot of salt molecules get left behind. And as those salt molecules concentrate more and more, as more H2O is evaporated, we end up seeing those congregate and basically create halite crystals, which are technically evaporites. So if you've ever been to the Great Salt Lakes or somewhere where there's salt flats, those salt flats are crystals that are made from the precipitation, evaporation from the water that's leaving the area. So then the NaCl is left behind and we see salt left behind. Crystallization from magma. So during melting of rocks, they remelt in the crust or in the mantle into this aqueous form. And then as they come to the surface or erupt out of a volcano, they start to crystallize. And as they crystallize, they form these really large scale crystals that we know as like quartz, calcite, things like that will crystallize out of a magma. All right, and then we have precipitation from organisms. So this is our biological component. So we have a couple of minerals here that we are referring to. So calcite and has calcium carbonate in it. And so this shell, for example, has a calcium carbonate outer shell, and that outer shell is technically made up of what we call calcite. When these organisms die and they fall to the ocean floor, it will accumulate and it will create rocks like limestone, which is primarily made up of this calcium carbonate material. And so this is where we can also see minerals form and rocks. All right, so we have a couple of mineral groups that we will talk about. We have the silicates and we have the non-silicates. These are the two big contrasting mineral groups, because one contains silica and oxygen and one does not. So we also subdivide them even further into more groups. So within the silicates, we have the olivines, the pyroxenes, the amphiboles, the micas, the feldspars, the quartz. And so when I start talking about some of these groups, this is what I'm referring to. The silicate minerals make up a large portion of our rocks, so they are one of the biggest groups of rock-forming minerals, whereas the non-silicates tend to be kind of on their own, and they are more of our native elements, our sulfides, sulfates, oxides, halides, carbonates. They are found in rocks, but they are not as big players in the building blocks of rocks. All right, so looking at silicate minerals, so here the big thing is that they contain the silicon oxygen tetrahedron. And so there's a silicate structure there for each of these different examples that are here on the left. And then you have the silica tetrahedron that is orbiting the page. And that is one silica to four oxygen. Okay, so that is the big influence here. You'll notice that on a lot of these, they have silica and oxygen in them, and their concentration is very similar to the silica tetrahedron, or they already have the silica tetrahedron. And as you move down this little chart here, you notice that those structures start to get more and more complex. And that's because the mineral is actually getting more and more complex. It's getting a more robust form. The way that it forms is getting more complicated. So for example, olivine comes out of a volcano and crystallizes very quickly at the surface, whereas quartz in general will crystallize below surface and takes a very long time to crystallize. You can get very big crystals out of it. So when we talk about silica minerals, this is what we are looking at. And a lot of these make up the majority of our crust, because as I said before, the two main elements that make up our crust are silicon and oxygen. And so all of these minerals have them. So that's where most of our crust is. All right, then looking at the non-silicate minerals, these have vastly different chemical formulas, as you can tell. They are subdivided based on what the majority of the elements present in them are. And so you'll see, for example, the oxides contain a lot of oxygen. The sulfides contain a lot of sulfur. The native elements are all one single element. Okay, so we'll go through these kind of individually. I'll show you some pictures of each of them. And they, like I said, do not contain the silica oxygen tetrahedra. All right, so here are the carbonates. They are made up of mostly carbon. So two examples here, calcite and dolomite. We will look at calcite in a lab, and we will talk about it a lot. Dolomite, not as much, because it doesn't form a lot of our rocks that we are really interested in for geology. But like I said, there are thousands of minerals out there, and we're only really going to focus on 20 of them, because these are the big 20 that really make up our rocks. All right, so halides made up of chlorine, fluoride, and bromide. And so we have fluorite and we have halite. So you can probably guess what fluorite has in it. Fluoride. Halite, like I said, is NaCl. And these are two of the minerals that we will focus on in lab as well. So these are our halides. Then we have oxides, which contain a lot of oxygen. They are also our metallic minerals. So I'll show you what metallic means in the next lecture. But we have magnetite and we have hematite. Hematite has kind of a specular form that we see here. And then magnetite, that is magnetic. Then we have our sulfides. So we have galena and we have pyrite here. Pyrite is fool's gold. Both of these, again, are also metallic minerals that contain a lot of sulfur. Then we have our sulfates, which contain sulfur and oxygen. This one is gypsum. You can tell that gypsum is not super robust because you can see a lot of scratches on it. So gypsum actually is really easy to scratch. And it's one of our big sulfates that we will look at. Then we get into our native elements. So this would be like silver and gold, graphite, sulfur, diamond. Again, these all only contain a single element within them. We will not look at very many of these. We'll talk about them a lot, but we won't necessarily look at them in hand specimen, and we only have a couple of them in the actual lab if you wanted to come in and look. All right, so to summarize this short PowerPoint, Minerals are made up of bonded elements from the Earth's crust. They can bond with covalent bonding or ionic bonding, covalent being the stronger bond. There's two main mineral groups, the silicates and the non-silicates. And minerals are derived from precipitation of aqueous solution or evaporation, magma, and organisms. With that, I will meet you guys in the next video, which is physical properties of minerals, and I will see you then. Bye.